hey there. Sometimes we don't know when the camera will cut on. So who knows what kind of strange expression I may be making, wondering. Anyway, we're here tonight before this open door, the symbol of the sign of today, right now the open door. And one of the things I do when I've talked a lot about leadership, Christian leadership, I've been in it all my life. I was raised amongst it, grandparents, parents, my own ministry before Dallas, and all my life, even from college up. Now, what I've done lately, you know, because it is this time of the year, I was thinking of the shepherding movement. I'm thinking of the shepherding movement. And so at Christmas time, we could say, there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And I've said this many times, that same analogy to the shepherding movement, because when I've been out, there's never been a movement or any kind of Christian ministry, black or white, and this is not the verse, that has ever pursued me for no reason, that has ever had a spiritual attack. I trigger it, and I'm not mad at it. It's just that, man, I didn't know it could be that ornery. I didn't know there could be a, you know, a cultish type of Christian ministry that moves in the Holy Spirit. And the reason I'm going to be really upfront, because I have to, I'm called to the Holy Spirit move, and it is a controlling Jezebel, witch watching, and also occult, and also undermining, not direct. So when I was laughing, I do laugh about it because it's so weird, I'll be honest. So I'm thinking, I've said this, I think I've written this on Twitter for a few years, and there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the many fields, keeping watch over their flocks and everybody else's, because that's how this acts. It's a old-timey law, Phariseeism, males and females, but the worst part that really bugs my spirit, because I am a prophetic person, a prophet, and a seer, doesn't have to be famous to, you know, you could be this real deal without, is that it does come assault my spirit and sidetracks me. And it is notorious for its crowds of false witnesses. We are surrounded by a crowd of false witnesses. I've never had anyone ever speak to me in a dress, yet I've been found fault with, and I'm out of order, unsubmitted. I've had people jump me in public. I've had people, when I walked up to say hand, you know, to say hello, introduce myself at one of these churches about 10 years ago, I didn't even get anything out of my mouth. They just looked at me and they said, you're out from under authority, you're unsubmitted. And I went, whoa. And this was a famous cult type group. I didn't know it was a cult at the time. But anyway, so when we deal with things that are that difficult along the way, the Lord had told me, you know, I was called, met the Lord as a child at 9, and my dad's revival service, his friend was preaching, rededicated my life outside the door when Billy Graham was preaching when I was 12 and my grandmother was listening. I didn't want anybody to know, you know, I was 12. Then when the Jesus People movement came in, I was in Norfolk, Virginia, and I didn't like going to church. I liked Jesus, but I didn't like dressing up and that formality tradition. And they hadn't started praise and worship, it was still hymns. I remember before that, when that happened, then the first musical that was like non-hymns through the Baptists was Pass It On. I love that. It was like traditional and it was setting the stage for the future. So then I was really in Norfolk, Virginia, was much more progressive, as they said, much more hard rock, much more, you know, naval base and things like that. It was not a small town at all, not reserved, and I really like that. I like cosmopolitan. I'd lived prior to a little teeny town, a little country town, rural town, and that was not me. I chafed, because I guess I have this thing. Growing up with my parents who were pastors in a little small town for a while, a country type of town, I learned as a little tiny child in the back, I don't like people watching my business. I don't want people minding my business, because I knew it was a sin from age 5 on up. I don't mind their business. If they're that curious, then you need to make an appointment and come over and chat. Otherwise, you're a gossip. Otherwise, you're a talebearer or whatever. So when I was 5 years old in the small town, let me do that a minute. My dad and mom had a church in a little town outside of Richmond. And they would go away to get away from the town where they worked and go into the big city of Richmond. So I'd be with them. I was the only child, the firstborn at the time. And they would say, I heard my mom say one time, because we had members that lived on the outskirts of the town. And I heard mom say one time, when I was like five in the back seat, she said, let's go out. She said to her, you know, my father, let's go out the other way, because those, that lady is always there. She and her friends that go to our church are always watching everybody and talking about them. So I guess something registered in my heart that day. It's wrong. It's a sin to gossip. It's a sin to mind people's business. And because I am not a gossip, and I have a good history of that, and I'm very fair, I'm very open, I'm very James 3:17, now I have to teach it, easily entreated, I always feel that it's fair to somebody. If you think they're in sin, you think they're evil, you think they're a witch, you think they're the closet so-and-so in sin, that if it is your business, that's another thing, if it is your business, then you're to make an appointment and humbly submit to God's whole counsel, Matthew 18:15, go chat one-to-one and find out. And humble, Galatians 6:1, meekly go over and find out. And if they're in sin, correct? Never, never, never has anyone in the wealth movement, male or female, black or white. Well, there are no black people in that movement. It's only white. So sorry. All right. Nobody has ever loved me enough, respected me enough to come over and get out of their thrones, their aristocratic hierarchy, their pecking order, their fault finding, stone throwing Phariseeism, and come over and find out who I am. Their friend. I've been their friend. So because the days are short and we're at an open door, I'm going to move on. I've already moved on from, you know, I love them, but I don't want to be in that. I don't want to feel that in my spirit, the doctrinal bathwaters of fault finding. I really don't. If they love me, they can figure out how to speak and we can be friends. But other than that, I'm going to move on. I really have been called more to signs and wonders. I really have been called to teach on prophecy. And if I were to settle for being, for having a occult, which occult spirits aimed at me from soulish prayers and fault-finding psychics, then I would not be able to function. Therefore, I had to be aggressive, assertive, and teaching what I teach. That's why I'm so, because I've been withstood. I didn't know I was being withstood. I was not raised around ministers who were withstanding, because Baptists generally aren't. Black people have not withstood me. Catholics, Methodists, certain kinds of Pentecostals, Vineyard, I don't think they've ever withstood me. They're speaking in tongues. It's just this one kind. And therefore, I have had to say it. I've had to study. You know, there's this book, and I'm not mad at them, and I'm not mean about it. I'm just saying I have to be this strong because I'm a pretty quiet, gentle soul. I'm a giant, a gentle soul. And if I'm sitting there, it comes and finds fault. If I just sit there because it, you know, two or three things out of that. Years ago, a pastor who was an apostle and a prophet, and he had a church in Central Virginia, and he edited my television show. I used to be on TV. I used to have a real office and everything in Virginia, around town. And so he one day said he'd been a missionary on the Nicaragua, Honduras, Dominican Republic, that type of field, many times. So one day he made the comment, he said, Tevo, never be afraid when a demon starts to manifest. Now see, this was like 20 years ago, and I was much more like, wow, I always wondered about that, because, you know, I wasn't raised around any kind of charismatic, spirit-filled Pentecost at all. So of course you have gaps you need to understand. So when he said, just casually, oh, Tevo, never be afraid when a demon starts to manifest, I went, oh, okay, let me know. Because I had wondered about it. So what he said was, don't be afraid if a demon starts to manifest. It's just a sign it's ready to be cast out. So that paved the way for when I would walk, be led of the Spirit. You know, the Lord led me since I was 24 to study the body, to surf the body of Christ, to study the doctrines. Well, this is the hard way of finding out their doctrines. So you just do your best. So you walk in. Oh, yes. Oh, wonder working power, maybe. Oh, beautiful worship. Oh, yes. Oh, let me see. They seem to be at peace. I noticed along the way that there's certain kind, you know, God has various facets of his nature. So some churches will be more tame, like God's calm side. Some people may be more fiery. Some people may be more introspective and seeking, and some may be more demonstrative. I can go with the flow. I have lots of energy, so I can, I like a lot of Pentecostal, but I'm not Pentecostal. I'm just like crossed by the unity, Book of Ephesians, which you can be anything. So you learn the hard way. You learn some of the difficult things you didn't know existed because you were never raised around that movement. I wasn't raised under the law. I wasn't raised around backbiting. I wasn't raised around fault finding. It was viewed as a classic sin. That's what I thought all Christians were like, but that's all right. So now we know and we address it for the sake of unity and the body of Christ, because it's not fair. Phariseeism is a perfect word. The Pharisees came after Jesus. He was the, they had their own cult going, they had their own system going, so Jesus was a part of that. And he troubled them by his spirit because he was free. But the Pharisees backbit and told tales, tried to get him into trouble, and also persecuted him. And then what it came to me was the Pharisees were not fair, you see. So now you can have the Pharisees of the old-timey law, country law, down in the new day, with many people, but you can also have the new Phariseeism, neo-Phariseeism, the trends, the yeast of the Sadducees, the yeast of the Sadducees, the latest trend, the latest style, the latest high persona, male or female, now has their way and their cult or their followers. I'm not saying they're all cults, but now has their traditions that they've come in since the 80s, 90s, 2000s, whatever. And it's nothing wrong with having good traditions, but the followers don't know they need to not start, be rigid in their bowing and scraping to those new traditions and keeping watch. See, it's the keeping watch that really fatigues me. It's a sign of legalism, lack of love, lack of understanding, immaturity. And then you can have occult in that, because the diehards, I had somebody when I was 20 years younger, 25 years younger, I was still my own ministry, and this new group turned out to be the whelp. I didn't know the new apostle in town, but I'd been around in ministry for 12 years or more, and then before that, in my on my own ministry, and from like 20 on up, 17, you know, around town, then I had official ministry in the former ministry called the Encouraging Word in 86. So I'd already been around all my life, and I know lots of people have not, you know, many people, it's nothing wrong with that. It's just a different testimony. You can have not raised around any kind of Christian, any kind of education, and that's not my case. I happen to have a lot of background in that that would help me understand and navigate the churches, the church. So there's nothing good or bad at that. It's just grace. And I'm on God's team, always have been. Well, I've been around on God's team for a long time. Well, the new group, the new, turned out they were well cult type spirit, not all. The new flow comes into town, TV affected, and then from a different part of the nation. And I've been there. Well, I was undergoing some private abuse, and I was also, I'd never met doctrine like that, that sort of patrician, that means elevated ministry, gotta have bowing and scraping, everybody, you know, they want their name known, and it's divisive in the fact that it wants its kingdom, its turf. And I wasn't raised around that. I don't think like that. I think everybody should have their turf, plus it's all white. It's pretty much all white. Later, one or two, you know, they're not trying to be biased, but they don't have the whatever it is. So I was new, but I was my own, I had my own ministry, my own call. So I would go and I would be sent and I would be led, and I had friends, I had my own ministry, and I had helpers at times. But I'd be sent on the sake of my mission from age 24 to study the body. And this was a new kind. I'd been through Vineyard. I'd been through, you know, beside Baptist and Jesus people, then I'd been through studying Vineyard, Holy Spirit, Word of Faith. So I'd been through Word of Faith, and I'm very Bible-oriented. But then they don't do a lot of deep worship, the spirit of prophecy. And that's also part of me. So I called the Word of Faith back then. I was sort of thinking, you know, like God has his different kinds of natures, his different niche, where he shows up in different ways to show part of his glory. And I thought, man, the Word of Faith are more demonstrative and they're more type A, assertive, you know, naming, you know, all those things. Well, then we went to the other side. It was new to me in 91. It was not like that. It was like seeking and introvert and introspective. And so I went in and everybody's really dressed down. It was at the end of the 80s where people were more in the dress up look, you know, the power look back then. And then this group was all really, I'm more dressed down all the time if I can, but I, you know, I try to look decent. So I walked in the first time, my friend and I went, I think, and I looked, well, I thought, wow, these people are all self-absorbed. And I went, wow, I was used to the happy clappy, you know, the type A. I thought, this must be one of God's type B ministries. They're seeking and self-absorbed. And I'm both. I can be that way, but I learned never be so self-absorbed that it's, you don't even notice a new person, a visitor, and don't even smile at people. And that was the case there. It was sort of, hate to say it, hangdog dysfunctional. I'm not putting down. But it was like a new thing. Well, for a while, I would go every so often. I wasn't a member ever. They were not over me. But I didn't know they would assume and presume they were. That was the hard part later, after a while. I didn't think like that because, see, I had my own ministry. I've had plenty of background. I've had nobody except for hand-picked board members, hand-chosen by God, and people similar to board members. Plus, I had a huge, you know, family of ministers. They always kept on my case, you know, I put it that way. So it wasn't anyone's business, but I didn't know that group, that kind of minister, presumes they are over their business, everybody's business. Let me tell you my shepherding history. When I went to college, went to a Baptist college, and the Holy Spirit movements came in, I started getting New Wine Magazine. New Wine Magazine was by the Don Basham, Judson Cornwall, somebody else from Florida. I liked that magazine. It was a really great magazine for the Holy Spirit. And I'd been through Jesus people. I knew, you know, the Bible, and it was really good. So then all of a sudden they started getting off, and it turned out they started or they were involved in the shepherding movement, and then I quit getting the magazine. That was the mid-70s. I never thought about it. Didn't bother me. I just thought, I'm not getting this. It was like, it's Levitical patriarchism. All the men rule. The woman has to check in. You know, it's like, it creates Phariseeism. And a lot of people watching everybody to see who's over it, who's submitted. And, oh, that has been my nightmare. That has been my worst. Alexander the coppersmith has done me much harm. So I didn't know this, though, then. So I was going there. Let's say that was the mid-70s, New One magazine. I quit it. I went in my own way. Everything was fine. No bad issues, no accusing, no Phariseeism, nothing legalistic when I went into my own ministry. And it was fine. Everything was good. However, once I started getting where they move in the Holy Spirit, that's when this started to find me. My first time that found me, I didn't know what it was. But I know people that can be, when you're getting in the Holy Spirit crowds, you can have people that are sort of off, and I'm trying not to be. I'm trying to have one foot. I'm not going to say I'll never be off, but I'm trying. So I remember I walked out to my car one day, my first time of being jumped, and a sister, I didn't know her, she had been watching me across the room of this one group, the whelp group turned out, the white group. And so she smiled and I smiled and I thought, that's fine. Well, on the way out of the group, she comes up, she says, "You have bad fruit." And I went, whoa, it's a spiritual attack. It was strong. Because you stir up jealousy. You can stir up jealousy. And I didn't know that. I was not ready for that. You know, a spiritual attack from a person. So you live and learn and see, this is it. When I go to the whelp group, the whelp people group don't receive me as a real leader. They are not used to women. They're used to fault-finding women coming down from, you know, Levi himself. And they're really into the hierarchy of strict patriarchal and hierarchical patricianism. Roles are very, you know, who's over who is very important. Well, I'm not used to that. I'm used to swarm ministry. Swarm ministry is like Mother Teresa. And hierarchy is more like Solomon, yet Solomon, these are not Solomon's, believe me, that do this. But I think it is the people that jump people, I think they are the ones that accuse people, need to be a Solomon. They have this issue of esteem, and maybe I stir up esteem because I have no issue with self-esteem. I may not be the best. I may not be the worst. I may not be the skinniest. I may not be the richest, but I don't care. I really don't care. I'm doing it for the audience of one. So I realized a lot of things that I stir up that are unpositive, that are difficult, it's got a lot of love of money that do this, that I stir up the group that have seemed to have a money issue, and I don't need to do that. I don't need to be around that. So when I look at turf protecting, worshiping a persona, and keeping a system, all of that is, to me, mammon-centric. It's a money-making sign of love of money. If you have an Eli Temple high priesthood, 1 Samuel fruit, misogyny, if you have the control, keep everybody under control and keep our system, algorithm going, legalism, money, love of money. If you have Demases, we're going to keep on going till we make it to the next level in our ministry. We want to make it blessed and we don't want to love anybody, but we want to make sure our needs are met. And we have that from the leadership. You know, it's love of money. So I have not felt good with a lot of charismatics because those two groups have that the most, my opinion. Not all, but they do. So I think, where would anyone in the wide world that says they're a Christian minister of any faith, of any part of the Christian community, any culture, would they think it is right, wise, or even loving to represent Christ and jump people in public, accuse them behind their back, be snakes in the grass and never confront them, but only read them and scan them, and then tell everybody else what they discovered after they read and scanned? See, I had to study this. It's that big. It is that big, all right? Now, when you look at the shepherding movement, good people can go, and gifted people, very, and I would like them to quell their need for power and control. And see, this is it. If I go, they're so biased that I go in, they're not whelp at all. I'm not a we-centric colonial. I look like one, but I'm not. I'm a we global, much more diverse, much more rhythm, much more energy. I don't think Phariseeism. I would think it would be a sin to be a Pharisee, frankly. So I'm here for not regal, but servant leader, and to do it for the sake of the community. See, I'm for community. This is not community. This is the style of clubs, but owning the turf. And they could be mega or micro. So I go in there, and I don't know this, and I rankle the spiritual powers that be, the demons in their midst. It really is amazing. So therefore, I had to grow up to do this by now. See, my dad was really gentle I didn't know people were like this. He wasn't a club member. He was like a real, he wasn't a cult type. He was like a real person. And I can tell when I'm in a different kinds of group just from walking in by now. So I think that for the sake of the gospel and the sake of the gossip, you better get yourself leveled and you better get yourself right for the sake of the Lord, the hero. The only hero is God. Jesus went about doing good, he related. Acts 10:38. All right. Jesus was a prophet, but he wasn't at the time of his arrival on the scene in ministry a famous prophet. All right. He was probably more like an infamous prophet. One more Jesus showing up, because they had a lot of Jesus back then. one more Messiah. Oh, we see them all. They probably thought he fit a stereotype, like they think I'm their stereotype in the Welt movement. Yeah, Jesus, we've seen him all our days. He used to go to temple when he was little and we raised him. How dare he usurp our authority? How dare he be in rebellion to our system? That's how they talk too. They really do. They're bad. He's in rebellion. Plus, guess what? I heard. They probably gossip about Mary. You know, I've been to Jerusalem and it's tiny. It's really narrow. And I can just picture the gossips. Everybody's eyeball watching Jesus every moment. And so, of course, the scuttlebutt from his birth on would be, it's probably illegitimate. Jesus, you know what? Don't listen to him. His mother is a, you know what? Prostitute, probably, because she is pregnant without being married. So that haunted him, surely, and he knew it. In those little tiny quarters, you know he had to deal with all the stuff, the scuttlebutt, and the powers that be. Plus, he was in Jerusalem, the mega capital of global spiritual dynamite of all kinds, good and bad. So when I think of the Bible, I think, man, I don't think like this. Where does this stuff come from? Where does this evil come from that presents itself and manifests itself in a Christian ministry that says it's a Christian movement? All right. I think you need to really examine your Bible. So what I've done is caused me that years ago, there was this book called The Art of War. It's a famous Chinese book called The Art of War. Well, I have my new one out. Online, at least. It's called The Art of Welp. Yeah. Know Your Accuser. The Art of Welp, Western European Levitical Patriarchism, The Art of Welp. I have gone back because of all the doctrines and all these cultish type prophetic movements. Certain ones are not as prophetic or cultish as the others, you know. Western European Levitical Patriarchy. I went back for the roots of Levi, the head of the tribe. When he was raised with two fighting women in chaos. His mother was Leah. He was the middle child. His mother was disfavored by the father who loved Rachel. He didn't like Leah, so he was angry. He and his brother Simeon were notorious as teenagers as murderous. There was a lot of rebellion. They usurped the father's authority, the patriarch's authority, when he said, do not. When their sister Dinah got raped by the neighbor tribe, Haman or somebody like that, then they wanted to, the father said, let's don't have bloodshed and murder. The man wanted to marry the daughter after he raped her. And they said, let's work it out. And they did. Well, the brothers, Levi and Simeon, went behind their father's back and they usurped their own father, rebellion, misogyny, anger, and they tricked the men of the tribe. They said, Levi went and said, you know, we won't let you marry our sister. We won't let your brother marry our sister unless you get circumcised. Well, the father didn't say that. They lied. So the men of the tribe said, okay, we want to keep peace. We're going to go and get circumcised. So on the third day they got circumcised. This is Genesis, I believe. Then Levi and Simeon went over and slaughtered the men because they were too... they were too sore to fight. So when we have scriptures about Levi, before he somehow must have transformed later to be the head of the tribe of Levi, the favored patriarch. Then we have his Orphic history, the bitter roots, the troubled roots, the misogynist roots of Levi. Evil. So we got to not have that. The good news is the Messiah Christ was not from the tribe of Levi, but the Levites in the temple were. The tribe of Levi is not Jesus' tribe. He comes down from the tribe of Judah through his mother Mary, and his father is God. So he didn't have that inherited disposition of sin. Baggage. All right. So I looked up, because of all this 30 years worth, all right, from behalf of the body of Christ, for the sake of the love of the Lord and the ministry. Then you get to know them very well, such as their pop psychology, their, you know, pop psychology, theophastic counseling type stuff. I'm not against all of that, but I'm saying certain ones, individuals, and a lot of them diagnose you from afar and will never speak and then tell everybody. It's the same thing, watching, scanning, diagnosing, gossip. No relationship. That's scary. It is really scary. I saw right Ode to Welp at the top of onlinefellowship.us. Call me, it's a parody, call me super spiritual. They look super spiritual. So when you get that kind of fruit, goofy fruit, you study it. You study the movement. All right. You think, what's good? Their gifts, their talent, their well-meaning. What's bad? It accuses. It lies. It's not trustworthy. It's a Judas spirit, all right? And it's a Jezebel because it controls. It is witch watching. It has some dark sides, all right? Then we have, I thought, well, you know, where does this come from in America? All I can figure is that it comes from the Deep South, where these people have all been Deep South that have done this to me. Maybe they were, they're usually, to me, it looks like a culture of nouveau riche. They used to be poor, now they're well off, gentrified in their own eyes. And, you know, now they are in a cult, they have a culture of this that are mean. Some of them are really mean. As I said, in their, what is it? I wrote on there about Welp studies. In their hearts, they know they're right. I've never met totalitarianism, fascism, until I met that movement in that culture. Not all of them, but it is huge. And bias. Next. So I studied, well, you know, before the Civil War, when they had the carpetbaggers and the people who were the slave owners, well, these are the slave drivers. I don't think they had enough money in their background. That's why they want money now. The patrician streak to own and to be aristocrats is because maybe they didn't have any money. They were from the poor that wanted power and position and title, and I didn't come from there. I'm sorry, I didn't come from that. So therefore, it stands out as a streak, as a bad witness to a Christian. Well, before the Civil War, there was more than that. There were the first colonies. I've traced it back to the Salem witch trials. Why? Let's put it this way. The Levitical patriarchs got off the boat. The New England patriarchs, the whelp from the Puritans, were whelp. Not all whelp are bad. We're grateful for the Puritans. They're a lot of heroes. Thank God for Puritans that came over the right kind. But within their midst, within the crowd of Puritans, were there some false doctrines and whelp that were the kind that were the massage witch watchers. All right, why? Because when you look back at the Salem witch trials of Salem, Massachusetts, you see that the certain groups within that group, the subculture, they had aught against women, and they had these trials where they took spectral evidence. That's a word to Google, spectral evidence. All right, you can hear the crowds here at the Barista Fellowship acting up, but they'll go. All right. So if you Google search spectral evidence, that is the witch-watching evidence, I call it. In the colonial days, they would have a trial. I saw Sister so-and-so. I say she's a witch. Let's put her on trial. And they killed women. They really did. anti-woman, which is just like Welp and Phariseeism. All right. What happened was the spectral evidence was intangible evidence. It wasn't like real evidence, but back then in the colonial days, they let it into court. The evidence was vibes, dreams, nightmares, subjective evidence, which they put in. I had a feeling, a suspicion that Sister Mary was a witch. And they put her on trial and they took it and killed her. And this is exactly what we fight today in that demonic stronghold of false teaching. That is it. So if I were to have a real person that was a real mature, loving leader say, Tavo, I think you're a witch. Well, come over. Talk to me. Tavo, I think I saw you in my spirit. You were committing the A word. I think you are in sin. Hey, come on over and ask me. You can ask me anything all my life. Doesn't bother me. Because my conscience is pure. Their conscience is rancid. Or they would come over and get off their high horse and make an appointment and talk to all of us. Not just me. This is not about me. This is about Satan manifesting in a Christian ministry. That's all this is. So the thing I have found the most difficult to deal with when I go pay the price, and I'm speaking of many, if I pay the price in my personal life to live and forgive and stand up for the Lord, if I have a huge deal going on in the ministry, heck on earth, and I go to take off and visit in their midst and fellowship with the saints, and I go in there to worship and get in with the Lord, I don't know what will happen if the whelp are there, the spirit. I will be scanned. I will be read. I will be avoided. I'll have the witch watchers come over. I've had witch watchers come over to me, sitting there for doing nothing except being there. So as a result, I think of the pastor who said, don't be afraid if a demon starts to manifest. It's just a sign it's ready to come out. So I take it like that. I just watch him. I think, wow, I can't believe this is going on under the name of Christ following. But I'm up for it. Let's see what they do. Let me study their doctrinal bathwaters. What color are they? What's their doctrine? Who's in charge? How many different, you know, how diverse are they? What's their politics? And so this is how I got it. When I was racially profiling me, I get racially profiled, but this only one kind. So therefore, I just started in the 90s when this started to happen, when I would go. Every time I went to a conference, and this was a whelp conference, it turned out, I found myself, I couldn't go up to say hello to the head leader, the male, the white patriarch, or they'd go, weird. And I'd been enriched in my own ministry, talking to ministers all my life. But I have a deliverance ministry, so it starts to manifest, so it can be taught, broadcast out, including through teaching, forgiving, having them encouraged to be mature and man up, human up. All right. I think a lot of people were taught false doctrine. They just don't know that they have been raised around a breed who bred them a false teaching, and it's now a cult. I never had this before. I never grew up around it. So now by now, after Dallas especially, I can go in there, and if it flares up, manifests, resists me, I had people over in one place before I got up here, and in the 2000s, I was in DFW, and I was sitting there after a service, calm service. I'd lost my mate. I was sitting there calmly after the service, and they send the witch watcher up. I'm sitting there, and this young woman, not too skilled, comes over, and she finds me at the very back, and she says, who are you, and why are you here? And I went, oh, no. The witch watchers. This group is sending the witch watchers. I trigger it. Only white ones of the whelp disposition. Nobody else. They're my nightmare. It's really weird. So you better grow up, Tavo. You better be strong to deal with this crowd. This is persecution. Demonic, devilish persecution. Am I mad at, no, now see, I know their theology. You say this, and the whelp hears, and they counteract with, she's finding fault. She is unforgiveness. It's her fault. She's in sin of unforgiveness. She's offended. They're in denial, that's all. She's offended. Listen, faithful are the wounds of a friend. Proverbs 27:6. Faithful are the wounds of the friend. You're needing, this is your deliverance. You're getting delivered. Should you care to really love people enough to go there? Now, when I'm talking like this, I'm trying to get past always talking so much about this. But I've been delivered, and anybody else you need delivered, I could help you deliver with teaching. I'm not going to lay hands and cast any devil out to my knowledge, but I will teach you online or off or chat with you about theology, because it is a yoke-breaking anointing that's needed to deliver you from some kind of false teaching. It really is. And I'm not saying it has to be spooky, not at all. It's like, you just need some scriptures. You need to know that it's not your fault. It's not in the Bible. It's not like Jesus. So to make a long message shorter, because I got to go, I would think for everybody, this is legalism, being permissive, false teaching, enabling, right? So what I would do to be proactive is say, everybody out there, don't go back under the law, Old Testament, especially if you're a prophet, all right? Read the Bible again, knowing Jesus is a prophet, that you want to be like Jesus. You want to be kind like Jesus. Read Jesus in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. This is the prescription to your deliverance from the law, from thinking Jesus is a misogynist, all right, a murderer, a liar, a backbiter, catching women in adultery, you know, all that stuff, Phariseeism, all right, false teaching. All you do, everybody can get their Bible out, read when Jesus was alive on the earth, walking around in ministry with his mama, with his family, with the area, and read Jesus in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospels, the good news, and see his relationships. Watch Jesus, every single relationship, male and female, brown and black and white, whatever, children, and see how Jesus acted and reacted. How he acted, how he reacted when they spoke back, and then you'll be free. Your prison house door will be open. You'll walk through into a great and glorious new day. It'll be out of sight. I gotta go for now. This is Tavo D'Arcy signing off for now. Great work. God is doing a great work in men and women. He's doing a great work. And we want to help you do the work of the Lord with your ministry. If you need to speak, to coach, to teach, to train, to mentor, let me know. God bless you. We have a humans ministry, not just women, not just men. It is a humans ministry of all colors. Bye-bye.